Thank you, Haakon, for the really inspiring words that you shared with us. For the last few years, I have been leading groups of philosophy for the children, and they have been a great reminder of what is our original potential, the potential of all of us. I remember once I was talking with eight-year-olds, and one eight-year-old asked this question that I thought was even better than I have heard at the university for a long time. The eight-year-old asked this question that, are we live or are we on video? And it's a wonderful question about, and a reminder about living in the now, that this moment is the only moment to show dignity and love. And in a way, there are only two things in life, love and fear, and or even life or death. And each moment you choose, or are you giving away your life to fear, or are you creating a more dignified world? And for me, fear is the way in which death exists in us already when we are alive. So fear is actually a little death. Well, for me, dignity is, first of all, the idea that every human being is valuable and has this special potential. Dignity means that you have to value yourself, you have to value also others. And if I think what has been an especially important inspiration about dignity for me, the greatest teacher about dignity for myself has been actually my own grandmother. She was born into a very poor conditions. Actually, of the eight children of the family, three didn't survive even childhood. So she had to leave home at the age of 16 to work as a servant at richer people's houses. And for the rest of her life, she worked as a cleaning lady, often doing two works at the same time. And one example she told me many times as an important message of dignity. Once she was again doing two jobs, daytime on a construction site and evenings at the governmental palace. And one night she was cleaning the Prime Minister's office very late in the evening. And suddenly the Prime Minister came back to the room and she was very nervous. She said that she felt that she's just an ordinary cleaning lady, and there was the political leader of the country. But what the Prime Minister said to my grandmother made a deep impression on her. The Prime Minister said to her, I'm sorry that I disturb your work in this way. It is people like yourself who put their whole heart to their work and family that have made this country what it is. And even if these were very simple words, they actually were very meaningful to my grandmother, because they answered to her deep human longing that we all share, this dream that I have, the dream that my dignity as a human being is recognized. I also remember me and my brother visited her every week, and she lived on a minimum wage, which was even smaller than it is now. And she used to save the whole week for the moment that we came to see her, not buying herself new clothes or new things, just in order to be able on that one day of the week that we went there to take us to a nearby cafe and buy us a little cake. Well, I have to say I'm not that big fan of cakes, but it did give me a big lesson about what it is to really want to create opportunities for a dignified life for someone else. And even now, every time I see a cleaning lady or a cashier or whoever, I actually think literally that this could be my grandmother. And of course, she is someone's grandmother or mother or daughter with this basic human dream about dignity being recognized. So my grandmother was my important inspiration, but also in another way. She also taught me about not giving away your life to fear. And there's one very interesting study about what is the most common regret of people on their deathbed. And actually, the most common regret of people on their deathbed is that I wish I had had the courage to be me. I wish I had not lived the expectations of others only. This is actually the most common regret, according to studies, that people have. And my grandmother was a big inspiration here, that you have to see what is valuable in yourself, not live only others' lives, and then help others based on that true self. And because of that, I have always paid a lot of attention that how much does our energy actually go to fear? How much of your life actually goes to fear? And I must tell one example that really amused me about observing myself, because I noticed that personally also I put a lot of energy in fear. And the situation was such that I like to go to classical music concerts. And I've always looked up admiringly to those people who at the end of the concert have the courage to stand up for applause and to shout bravo. And I have been for a long time looking upwards and thinking that one day I will also get that courage. But then every time when the concert was nearing, I froze in fear, thinking something like that. What if I stand up and shout the bravo and it doesn't come out in a sufficiently lively Italian way, but instead puffs out somehow embarrassingly, and there I am standing completely embarrassed and life is over. And then I thought that this has to end, that you are talking about courage and you're fulfilling your potential, that you must be able to get through that. And then one time before a smaller concert, a chamber music concert where there are only four players, I made an absolute promise to myself that now, when this concert is over, and regardless of how good or bad it was, I will be the first one up for applause and shouting bravo. And this is what I did, of course, safely abroad. And I must tell that anyway, it was actually a very emancipating moment more generally. So remember that the most common regret of people on their deathbed is that I wish I had had the courage to be me. There's a... Thank you. Thank you very much. This is getting really great now. We have to keep this atmosphere. There's actually one small song that I use for myself to remind about this fact that the only possible moment to show dignity and love is now. And that you have to get the courage to be you. And it's a very famous Finnish song called Niin kaunis on maa by Kari Rydman, a composer who I really respect. And I even went to meet with him to learn what is the meaning of the song. Because it's a beautifully mysterious song that is at the same time very sad, but also very joyful. Because it's played both at funerals and also in the spring celebrations at schools. And he said that this is actually a deep insight of the song's meaning. And then I talked with him, and it turned out that the actual message of the song is to say that actually life wins. But how does it win? This is my reading of the song. His answer is that only by doing acts of dignity in the now, we actually exist in each other as life-carrying forces. And in this way, life wins. And in the song, it is the child choir that forms that larger we in which life wins. And then he told the immediate background of the song, which is that Kari was a music teacher in a school when his own student, a 10-year-old girl, Thea Partinen, was hit by the car in front of the school. And then in an enormous burst of emotions, he composed this song to express what he felt then and to pay respect to the memory of Thea. And then the next day at school, the song was performed so that the school's children formed the choir. Let's listen to a small section of the song and let us thoughts go to where they go and ultimately remind us that the only possible moment to show dignity and love is now. Okay. So my final message tonight is that your life is limited. Don't waste it. Have the courage to be you. Thank you very much.